Revival was birthed in drunkenness. And if we ever lose that, we'll lose the power that has been born out of this presence revival. So I need you to, when you're walking down the halls, to stop at various offices and take a drink with each other. I need you to be drunk. He said this. He said, I'm very concerned because I'm not seeing people flopping on the ground during the day. He said, I long for the days when I come into the office and I have to crawl over the receptionist and my personal assistant because they're intertwined on the floor laughing. He said, listen, if we ever lose the presence, we'll have to revert to performance and program. And there's no power in that. That's religious. We must have the presence. And we must never forget that it's the joy, it's the laughter specifically that releases the power of God's presence on the earth. He says what we're enjoying today in this new revelation that's bringing the church into a whole new level of expression and expansion of the kingdom of God is the joy of the kingdom of God, which includes the oil of gladness, celebration, and primarily laughter. So in other words, what I'm trying to get at is joy is not just an ancillary part of the kingdom of God. It's righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Spirit. Without joy, you have no kingdom. So I want to propose to you that if we don't have joy working in our lives, we may need to rethink whether or not we have the kingdom within us. If the kingdom of God consists of joy, and he who is enthroned in the heavens laughs, Psalm 2:4, the context there is that he looks at the plots and the plans of the enemy, the strategies of the enemy to thwart the plans of God, and his response is not, oh, what are we going to do? His response is, Now, God didn't just laugh one time in history and said, okay, now that's enough. Let's get on to maturity now. No, if you look that up in the Hebrew, it's a continual laughing. So if the kingdom of God consists of joy, if we say we have the kingdom of God inside of us, you're saying, but I'm depressed. I know, he turned our mourning into dancing and our sorrow into joy. And he's given us the oil of gladness. You see, this was what was promised in Isaiah 61 as a messianic promise, prophetic promise of what the Messiah would bring when he came in bringing the kingdom of God. Well, aren't we supposed to weep with those who weep? Of course we are. But don't leave them there. Like when my daughter, you know, she was growing up and she would get rejected at school or something bad would happen. She'd be up in her room and I'd hear, and I'd knock on her door, what? What do you want? And I'd come in and, what's wrong, honey? I just had a bad day. I didn't say, get over it and laugh. I mean, what kind of a compassionate father would do something like that? He's the God of compassion. The Holy Spirit is our comforter. So I would come as a good father, and I would put my arm around her, and I'd say, tell me all about it. What's that? And my heart would ache with her pain. And I would listen to her, and I would comfort her. But after a while, after a certain time, and it's different every time, at some point, it would be like, okay, honey, what can I do to make you happy now? What can I do to make you happy? A new pair of shoes? Okay. Come on now. Let me see that smile. I remember we would be driving sometimes and she'd, you know, just be hurt or in a bad mood or whatever, and she'd always turn away. And when she was like 5 or 6, she didn't realize I could see her reflection in the window. And so I'd see her and she'd be like, and I'd be, come on, let's just see a little smile. Come on, make your daddy so happy. I want to see that smile. Your smile is so beautiful. And she'd be like, and like turned away like I couldn't see, right? Yes, our Father comforts us. He helps us through the pain, the trials that obviously come in our life. But pain lasts for a night, but joy comes in the morning. And I want to tell you that in the kingdom of God, it's always today. It's always today. It's always morning. It's never evening in the kingdom. He turns our M-O-U-R-N-I-N-G into M-O-R-N-I-N-G. Paul says in Ephesians 5:18, do not be drunk with wine, which leads to debauchery. And debauchery is an old English word that means you do things that you are or should be ashamed of the next day. Has anybody ever been in that situation? Yeah, don't raise your hand. It's all under the blood now, okay? Don't be drunk like that, because you're going to lose all of your inhibition. You're going to lose all of your fear of consequence. You're going to lose all of your fear of man. And you're going to do crazy, stupid things that you either are or should be ashamed of. So don't be drunk like that. Rather, be drunk with the Spirit. Be filled with the Spirit. It's a contrast. God's desire for us is to be drunk. On the day of Pentecost, we're not drunk like you think we're drunk. We're not drunk on wine. It's only 9 in the morning. But we are hammered. And 3,000 people came into the kingdom of God, I believe, because they got drunk. It's time for the church to get drunk and to stay drunk. I was telling the church where Randy pastors down in Forest, I want to come out with a new 12-step group. You know, you've heard of Al-Anon. You know, it's for the spouses of addicts, alcoholics. Well, I want to come out with a 12-step group called On and On. Like, you get drunk, and you just keep getting drunk. This book right here will help in that process. This is a great On and On support group curriculum right here. And if you want more of the theology of drunkenness, this book is the best book I've ever read on the theology of drunkenness. In releasing the supernatural power of God, expanding the kingdom of God. So I just want to release a drunkenness of joy. What I like to do is I like to put my arms out like that and make like a prophetic funnel, like an oil funnel, oil of gladness coming in. And then sometimes I'll just put my head back and open my mouth just as a prophetic act and just gulp. Gung, gung, gung. I want all of it. Yeah. Our teenagers are waiting for the new wine of heaven. Our nursery, especially the nursery workers, we teach our kids to drink early in life at our church. That's why our kids, 5, 6 years old, they go around healing the sick. Yeah. Okay, now, we're not sad drunks. We're not mean drunks. We're loving drunks. We're happy drunks. So it really does help when you're receiving to go ahead and like let your face know what's going on. Have you guys ever been drunk? Last week? Last night? Come on. Yes. How was it? Did you wake up feeling really bad and guilty? Regretted everything? What's that? Your throat hurt bad the next day because you were laughing so much? I've never met anybody who got drunk in the Holy Spirit laughing who wanted to kill themselves. I want to kill myself. I want to kill you. It's like laughter is the lubricant of the kingdom. Turn real quick to John chapter 17, because I know you're having a hard time with this. Some of you. Okay, John chapter 17, and I'm going to get into my message. In John 17, Jesus prays a prayer for the disciples, his last prayer for the disciples. John 17 actually is born out of Ezekiel 47. I don't want to take time to go and read through all that, but Ezekiel 47 is a picture of how the kingdom of God is going to be released in the river of God. The river of God is the Holy Spirit, and I want to propose to you that the river of God that's coming out of the throne room, the south side of the altar was where the worship took place, out of that place of intimacy. Now, some of you right now are like, can't they control themselves? If they were crying, you would like be saying, oh, the Holy Spirit's really working. So thank you for helping me out here. I'm loving this. This is in order because I want it to happen. If somebody else is teaching and they want to teach in seriousness and to honor them, we don't do that. But I like it. Bob and Char, we were down in Argentina, and I was speaking. I think it was the first time I was speaking. And Apostle Martin and Bob and Char, they're on the ground roaring with laughter during my whole message. And they were so apologetic. And I was like, no, that was the best response that I could ever even hope for in a message. You're going to worry me if you're not smiling, okay? If you're not laughing. Then I'm going to have to resort to jokes, and then you're really going to start crying. You'll leave. But John 17, Jesus' last prayer is predicated on Ezekiel chapter 47, where the river is flowing out of the south side of the altar, where it's that intimate place of his presence. And it's only out of his presence that we can ever change the world around us. And if you notice in Ezekiel 47, as you read it later, the further they get away in risk, by the way, the further they get away in risk from the throne, the more the kingdom of God is expanded. The kingdom of God is never going to be expanded inside the church. It's always going to be out. He led me out of the south side of the altar. And the river always flows out. The river doesn't flow in, it flows out. It starts off small in us, and the more we give away, the more we get. Measured back to us, according to his measure, pressed down, shaken together, and what? Running over. So Ezekiel 47 was actually proclaimed by Jesus in John chapter 7, verse 37, on the Day of Tabernacles, the last and greatest day of the feast, the eighth day, in which the priests would take the silver bowl, and where they would wash for their sins, and they would take everything down to the pool of Siloam, and they would be accompanied by the musicians and the dancers, and it was a party going down to celebrate the end of sin, basically. And so Jesus stands up on this last day and says, if you're thirsty, come to me and drink, and rivers of living water will flow from within you, which is really a fulfillment of Ezekiel chapter 47, which is a prophetic picture of the kingdom of God coming onto the earth through the messianic ministry of Jesus, and then subsequently the church on the day of Pentecost. And so so in John 17, then Jesus is praying for his disciples that Ezekiel 47 and John 7:37 would be fulfilled in them. And this is what he says. He's praying. And in John 17, I'm not going to even read the whole thing here. You can read it yourself later. But just trust me, he prays for six things. He prays, John 17. He prays for six things in John 17. He prays that the disciples would be sanctified. He prays that the disciples would be protected. He prays that the disciples would be unified. He prays that the disciples would encounter his glory. He prays that the disciples would encounter his presence, and he prays that the disciples would encounter his love. Those six things he's praying in John chapter 17. For what purpose? Look at verse 13. In verse 13, Jesus is praying. He says, I'm coming to you now, Father. He's speaking to the Father. I'm coming to you now, Father. But I say these things. Whenever you see a these things, you have to figure out what these things refer to. I say these things, these six things, that they would be protected, that they would be sanctified, that they would be unified, that they would encounter my glory, that they would encounter my presence, and that they would encounter my love. I'm praying these six things for one purpose, one reason. I want them to have all of these things for one purpose. I'm coming to you now, Father, but I say these things while I am still in the world. Why? So that they may have a full measure of my joy within them. God wants us to be restored into right relationship to him for one reason, so that we would have a full measure of his joy within us. He wants us to be sanctified. Why? So we would have a full measure of his joy within us. He wants us to be protected. Why? So that we would have a full measure of his joy within us. He wants us to be unified together. Why? So that we would have a full measure of his joy within us. He wants us to experience his glory, the manifestation of his goodness. Why? So that we would have a full measure of his joy. He wants us to experience his presence when we come into a place of worship. Why? So that we would have a full measure of his joy within us. He wants us to encounter his love so that we would have a full measure of His joy. Everything that God does for us and in us is for one purpose. And that one purpose is so that we could have a full measure of His joy within us. That's why joy is such a big deal. That's why joy is not just an ancillary option for the Christian life. It's the very essence of the Christian life, and it's the very element that propels us into fulfilling our supernatural destiny. The joy of the Lord is our empowerment. So then we have to ask ourselves, what constitutes a full measure of Jesus' joy? If He wants a full measure of His joy in us, how big is that? What is His container size of joy? Like a shot glass worth? A bottle worth? A kegger worth? A water truck worth? A lake size? Well, let's just cut to the chase. It's immeasurable. It's infinity. It's eternal. God will never run out of joy. Never. He who is enthroned in the heavens laughs. Forever. Forever. You say, well, doesn't He ever speak and talk? Well, He can multitask. Let's just pretend for a moment. Let's imagine just for a moment that this represents Jesus' container size, which is a full measure of joy. Now we know that this is eternal. It's immeasurable. But for the sake of illustration, just imagine this is the full measure of Jesus' joy that He wants to pour into us. So then let's imagine that this is our container size, which is finite. So what's going to happen when the full measure of Jesus' joy is poured out into us? We are going to drink because we're thirsty. We're going to drink, and then what's going to happen? We are going to leak. We're going to drink, and we are just naturally going to leak. Oh! He just got healed. How did that happen? Oh, I was just drinking. Oh! Here, take some presents, therapy. Yeah. Well, how do you change the world around you? You just drink. You just drink, and it just... This is the normal, supernatural Christian life. You see, it's not about striving, working hard, performing well. It's all about receiving, drinking, and leaking, and releasing. That's the Christian life in a nutshell right there. See, that's the way most Christians act. They pretend like they're going to do something, and then they fool everyone and don't do anything. See, when I get drunk, I don't care what people are thinking about me. Instead of doing crazy, stupid things that are evil, I do crazy things that are bringing righteousness about. So just go ahead and put your hands out again and say, God, I want a full measure. I want a full measure every day. I want to be an on and on Christian. I want to be the leader of the support group. Whoa! I'm sure the kids in the audience are like, wow, it's about time. Oh. Drunk people take more risk than do sober people. This book will teach you how to live in risk. Oh. That was a commercial break right there. We're going to go after some miracles tonight, but before we do that, I want to just talk to you a little bit about one of the things that joy and out of joy and expanding the kingdom, what that kind of looks like as we spoke about righteousness, peace, and joy being a practical demonstration of the expansion of the kingdom of God, the presence of God, the Holy Spirit, right? When we release the Holy Spirit, we're releasing the kingdom of God. And when we release the kingdom of God, the Holy Spirit, the presence of God on people or in an environment to change the atmosphere, it looks like something practical. It looks like a demonstration of power in releasing righteousness, peace, and joy into people's lives so that they're transformed. So it's not just a theory. You can actually see the effects of it. It's practical. I was just recently in the newspaper in our city in Reading, and I was also on Channel 7 News, and the reason why is because my next door, I was drunk. My next door neighbor called me about 3 weeks ago on a Saturday afternoon. He says, hey, I think somebody just went into your next door neighbor's yard and they're robbing the place. And they came to my house, and then I saw them go to your house and knock on the door and then look in your cars, and then they went to your other next door neighbor's house and they went up to the front door and then they went to the side and went into the backyard. I think they're robbing their house right now. So I'm like, you know, they're watching some football or the U.S. Open or something like that. I don't know, tennis or whatever it was. I don't know. Trying to take a nap. and so I jump up and, you know, I put on my tennis shoes, and he comes over and he's got his 9mm in his holster, and he's a former Army. What is the special forces for the Army? Ranger. He's a former Ranger. And so I feel like, come on, let's go. You know, let's do this thing. And so we knock on the front door, nobody's home. And so we go into the backyard, and he takes one side of the backyard and I take the other. And it's like on a tier down this little hill, and there are like four tiers. And I get down to the bottom and I see the robber there at the bottom. And I'm like, what are you doing? They're like, oh, I was hungry and I saw some fruit and I thought I'd get something to eat. And I go, no, you're not. You were robbing this house. We're calling the police and we're arresting you right now. No, you're not. Yes, we are. Come with me. And I went to grab him and pull him up this little embankment and kick me and ran away. And I had to chase this robber down, tackle them, and drag them back to the street. And I had to, like, put my knee into them. Like, it was crazy. It was, like, wild. And the police finally got there, and they were like, job, well done. And the Army Ranger guy's just watching me do this whole thing. I'm like, why didn't you jump in? And he goes, you were doing a great job. I'm like, thanks. I mean, like, I got this big old knot on my knee. I got kicked, and it was crazy. But yeah, I had to take this robber out, you know. And so the newspaper came and interviewed us and the whole bit. And my next-door neighbor who was being robbed, I've been trying to witness to these guys for 5 years, and they're into total New Age stuff and don't want anything to do with Christianity or anything. But I went over, when they got back, I went over and told them what had happened. And an hour later, I was coming out of my house, and there was a huge vase of roses on my front doorstep with a note saying, "Thank you so much." And I realized that in that protecting them, that was one of the best demonstrations of the good news that they could have enjoyed. So just last weekend, I was in Reno, Nevada, just 3 hours from Redding, where I live, and I was helping a little church plant that came out of our fire starters class in Redding, California, and they just started a church 9 weeks ago, and they already have 70 people through this fire starters class, in which everybody has gotten trained and so amped up, like our African American, you know, just all of a sudden they think they can change the world. They don't know any different, and they just go. They're so ignorant, they don't know anything, which is usually the best way to go about it. You know, and so, these are all brand new believers. It was such a great time. Well, I was there Thursday night, Friday night, and after Friday night, we were going to go get something to eat. And it was about 11 o'clock at night, and so everything's kind of closed down a little bit, so we needed gas, and so we go into this gas station that's closed, except for you can get gas with your credit card. And so we're the only car there, and we're getting gas, and I'm with this other 70-year-old guy who's a part of my ministry team from Reading. He's the most awesome guy. He was an atheist up till 5 years ago. And he got saved, came to our school of ministry, and now he's a Sozo trainer. And he's a leader of fire starters, and he's taking fire starters and Sozo all over the world and seeing blind eyes open, deaf ears healed, and he's just having the time of his life with he and his wife. So he was on this trip with me because he also plays golf really well. It's one way to get on my ministry team, you know, if you play golf. Yeah, Randy plays golf. And so we're getting gas, and the pastor and his wife are in their van while we're out getting gas and so forth. They're in my ministry team guy's van, and so we're standing there talking while we're pumping gas, and all of a sudden this car pulls into the driveway and over off to the side, and we hear these girls yelling in the car, screaming, and I'm like, what's going on there? And all of a sudden they jump out and they're in like prom dresses, but it's too early for prom or even homecoming at that point. And I'm like, what is going on? And they're crying and yelling, and one of them's on the cell phone giving directions to where they're at. And I'm like, what is going on? And then this other girl gets out and she's got a white dress on, and I'm thinking, that looks like a wedding dress. And just then this guy comes out, this Hispanic guy, tattoos all over him, this big guy with like no shirt on. And they're yelling and screaming at each other. And she's like, "You've ruined my life, and you ruined my night. I hate you." And he gets out, and then she starts going after him, and he starts running around the parking lot, and she's gonna get him. And so finally, he turns around and punches her in the face. And I'm now standing 30 feet away, and I yell out, "No, no, 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 no. This is not happening. You don't touch her." So he turns to me, and he goes, "Then I'll F you up." Now I've got this 70-year-old ministry associate with me who's a golfer. I don't have, you know, the Army, you know, ranger with me. So I'm like, no, like, so I'm like, I like turn to the side here, and I'm waiting for him. Like, he's obviously hammered drunk, and he's like coming up like he's, you could tell he's been in a lot of fights before. And so I'm thinking, God, help me here. Where should I hit him first? You know? Like, God, give me grace to get it right the first time. So he comes up to me, And I say, hey, listen. You don't want to make this any worse on yourself than it is. I go, listen, I'm a pastor, and I can help you. And he runs away. Yes. And I start prophesying to him as he's running away. The cops show up about a minute later, 30 seconds maybe. And now I've got these two girls, which turns out to be the sister and the niece of this bride. And they're crying. And I'm like, so do you guys like living in this kind of environment? Is this working out good for you? Are you making good choices in your life? Are you excited about the lifestyle you're living? And they like start telling me their whole life, and they're confessing their sins right there. And I'm like giving them wise counsel, and I'm giving them compassion. And both of them at the same time, they jump up off of the island of the gas station pump area there, and they just hug on to me. Then the police come over, and I'm prophesying over all of them. Then the family shows up of the wedding party, and now I've got them all like in this like little half circle here, and I'm preaching the good news to them and prophesying about all of their destiny. And it was just such a great like outpouring of God's presence to turn something that was so wrong into something that was so right. And by the end, you know, the bride, the pastors got out of the van, and they were ministering to the bride in the car while I was ministering to the others outside. And by the end, it was like they were so thankful that we were there. That we were there. And I want to suggest to you that God is looking for people who will be there. God is looking for people who will watch out for their neighbor. God is looking for people who will intervene at a gas station. God is looking for people who will release justice. Turn in your Bibles real quick to Matthew chapter 12. I want to talk to you for just a little bit about justice, and then we're going to release justice tonight. Because some of you think of justice and you think immediately punishment. I want to talk to you from a little different perspective tonight. In Matthew chapter 12, Jesus has healed somebody on the Sabbath. And he's in trouble for it. And in verse 15, aware of all this trouble, Jesus withdrew from that place and many followed him. And he healed all their sick, warning them not to tell who he was. And this was to fulfill what was spoken through the prophet Isaiah. So he's healing people on the Sabbath. He's healing everybody in sight. And he's getting in trouble for it. And so he has to leave. And so this was to fulfill what was spoken through the prophet Isaiah. Here is my servant whom I have chosen, the one I love, in whom I delight. I will put my spirit on him, and he will proclaim justice to the nations. He will not quarrel, which is actually he will not strive or cry out. No one, in other words, he won't promote himself. He's not going to strive in performance for approval. No one will hear his voice in the streets. A bruised reed he will not break, and a smoldering wick he will not snuff out till he leads justice to victory. In other words, those who are broken, those who are hurting, he's not going to make it worse on them. He's not going to take a broken reed and make it worse and break it even further. What he's going to come and do, he's going to make that wrong thing right. He's going to release righteousness as he carries out justice. Justice is the administration of righteousness. We spoke this morning about righteousness. And remember, I was speaking about righteousness this morning, and it's the Greek word dikaiosyne. Dikaiosyne is what we translate righteous, which comes from an old English word, right-wise, which was later morphed into right-ways, which was later morphed into righteous, dikaiosyne. Now, justice is the key. which is the root of dikaiosyne. Justice and righteousness are very, very similar. When you're just, you are right. You are upright. And that's where we get the term dikaiosyne, which is righteousness. Righteousness is the foundation, and justice is what releases the right thing into the environment or the circumstance, the relationship, or the person's life. Without justice, righteousness is never released. Justice is the helping, it's the doing, it's the action of righteousness. Without justice, righteousness never will come on the earth. Jesus came to release justice. When he was releasing justice, he was actually establishing righteousness. This is so important for us to understand. Now, these verses here, taken from Isaiah, is actually taken from Isaiah chapter 42. And in Isaiah chapter 42, if you would just turn there for a moment. In verse 4, verse 1, here is my servant whom I uphold, my chosen one in whom I delight, 42:1. I will put my spirit on him. This is a prophetic promise for the servant of the Lord, the messianic servant, coming to bring the kingdom of God. So this is describing how the kingdom would come when Jesus appeared on the earth. I will put my spirit on him, and he will bring justice to the nations. He will not shout or cry out, or raise his voice in the streets. A bruised reed he will not break, and a smoldering wick he will not snuff out. In faithfulness he will bring forth justice. He will not falter or be discouraged till he establishes justice on earth. In his law the islands will put their hope. In other words, when we become administrators of justice, just as Jesus was an administrator of justice in Matthew chapter 12 and wherever he went, the islands will then begin to put their hope in us because they'll rely upon us for the answers. It's like right now, the public, you know, the community doesn't really see the church as a benefit, as a value. Why? Because we've really not upheld justice the way God intended for us to uphold justice. God is looking for servants, just like he was looking to bring the Messiah, the servant, Jesus, to bring the kingdom of God. He's still today looking for servants who will administrate justice on the earth, who will be willing to intervene into the affairs of the people on the earth. And what will happen is that the people will then begin to put hope and trust in you because they'll know that you have the answer. That you can make wrong things right. Verse 5, this is what God the Lord says, he who created the heavens and stretched them out, who spread out the earth and all that comes out of it, who gives breath to its people, life, the wind, the pneuma, the ruach, and life to those who walk on it. Verse 6, I, the Lord, have called you in righteousness, right ways. I will take hold of your hand. In other words, God is committed to bringing us into all his right ways, so that we can experience the blessings and the benefits of his kingdom in our lives. He's going to establish every way that's in our life right. That is such great news, that God is committed to making everything in our life right so that we're totally blessed. I, the Lord, have called you in righteousness. I will take hold of your hand. I will keep you and will make you to be a covenant for the people and a light for the Gentiles. When we release the justice of God in a community, in an environment, that's when we become the light of the world. Being the light of the world, shining, is releasing the righteousness of God, the right ways of God, into the culture, into the environment, into the atmosphere, into people's lives, into circumstances. So you'll be a light for the Gentiles. Verse 7, to open eyes that are blind, to free captives from prison, and to release from the dungeon those who sit in darkness. This is justice being released. Now, turn over to Isaiah chapter 61, because this is another prophetic messianic promise of what it would look like when the servant Jesus, the Messiah, would show up to expand, release the kingdom of God in the atmosphere, in the environment, in the world. In Isaiah chapter 61, verse 1, the Spirit of the Sovereign Lord is on me. Why? Because the Lord has anointed me to what? Preach good news. And what is the good news? The good news is the kingdom of God on earth. The good news is a demonstration and a presentation and a demonstration of power of the kingdom of God, which looks like righteousness and peace and joy being released everywhere we go. I have anointed you to preach good news, not to just talk about it, but to do it practically. How are we going to bring about righteousness, peace, and joy? By releasing justice, administrating justice, by intervening in our justice, carrying out righteousness. Like if you are in a court of law and the judge makes a righteous decision, a righteous judgment, without justice, righteousness is never carried out. You don't get justice until either the reward or the punishment is mitigated and carried out. When God releases his righteousness in a declaration of his judgment of righteousness, it's carried out through his justice, so it's made visible, manifest. So, he has anointed me to preach good news to the poor. He has sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim freedom for the captives, and release from darkness for the prisoners, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor and the day of vengeance of our God. Now, I want to focus on this phrase right here, because many people have so misquoted this verse. They'll often say, the Lord's going to get you. He's coming. His vengeance is coming. Well, I want to declare to you tonight, that's not what that means at all. In fact, this word vengeance, if you looked in the Hebrew, it's naquam. And in the Greek Septuagint, which is the translation of the Hebrew into Greek, it's the Greek word imera, which actually means judgment. The day of judgment is going to be proclaimed. Now, when people think of judgment, they immediately think of something negative. But I want to propose to you that the judgment that God is bringing is, number one, judgment on the enemy, but a judgment of righteousness being released. He's looking down from heaven, and he sees all of the unrighteousness that the devil has sown into the world, all the havoc that he's wreaked, all the sickness and the disease and vile relationships and every kind of evil. And he says, I am declaring, I am making a judgment right now of righteousness, that righteousness is going to come on the earth. This is my judgment, that righteousness is coming from heaven to earth. So for this reason, Jesus came, 1 John 3:8, to destroy the works of the devil. So God in heaven has declared in a judgment of righteousness. He says, listen, everything's been wrong, but from this time forth, when Jesus shows up, when you show up, things are going to change, because you are going to be administrators, ambassadors of justice. You're going to intervene into the lives of people. You're going to take what the devil has come to kill, steal, and to destroy, and you're going to thwart the devil's plans and purposes, and you're going to intervene on behalf of God, and you're going to administrate the judgment of God in righteousness that sets them free, that makes them whole, that causes the blind to see, causes the lame to walk. And you're going to then preach the good news that way. And when the good news comes, everybody will know that justice has finally arrived on the earth. And then they're going to put their hope and their trust in you. And of course, we know that Jesus' first message in Luke 4, 18 and 19 was Isaiah 61. This is why he came. This is how we release the good news of great joy. We are administrators of God's justice. Ministrating his righteousness, his peace, and his joy wherever we go. And he's calling us right now. I could go on and on about this justice thing, but I want to release some justice tonight. I want to release some healing tonight. Oh, yes. Just like I detained that robber, just like I intervened in that domestic dispute, right now we want to make wrong things right. Oh. Somebody here, you actually have a tailbone problem, and I think that it might have been caused while you were giving birth. I think there's a woman here, obviously. If you're a man and you stand up for this, we're going to release some justice on you. But I think there's somebody here, and you were injured while giving birth, and I think it affected your tailbone. And who is that? You've had problems maybe for years and years, and you've kind of even learned to live with it. Is that you? Okay. Could you? Is it? Does it hurt from time to time? Is it hurting right now at all? Okay, well then I just declare a judgment. I just declare a judgment from this point on that no pain into that tailbone. So, yeah. Somebody here, you have pain in your ear? I also buzzing. I don't know, ringing, but buzzing. Is that you right next to her? Okay. And sometimes this happens, like people will, like words of knowledge will spill over to the next person. So you have pain as well? Buzzing. Okay, well, we just say right now, no more. Yeah. Is it buzzing? Okay, go out into the room back there and come back and let me know. Yeah, because right now it's justice is coming to those ears. arthritis in the wrists and maybe even I just heard wrists. Is that you? Does it hurt right now? What about right now? Okay, can you kind of do some push-ups or something? And does it hurt right now? Okay, like, so you can make it hurt. Try to make it hurt.
It hurts more if I do something I'm not thinking about it.
Okay. Okay, yeah, she's pointing out the exact spot. So we just released justice. Remember, overflowing joy. I was praying over a guy one time. He came up to me in a meeting and he said, "Hey, can you go after creative miracles?" I said, "Sure." He holds up his hand and he's missing his thumb on his left hand. So I looked at it and started laughing because it was impossible. You know, like Abraham and Sarah, you know, they were told they were going to have a child way past their time. And Abraham fell face down before God in Genesis 17 and laughed. And Sarah did the same thing in the next chapter. And God said, "You were laughing, weren't you?" "No, I wasn't." "Yeah, you were." A lot of people say it was a mocking laugh. It wasn't a mocking laugh. God didn't get mad at her, and he didn't get mad at Abraham either. He didn't even say anything to Abraham. He just wanted to remind Sarah that she was laughing. Do you know what they named their child? Laughter. Isaac means laughter. I believe Abraham and Sarah got into the hall of faith in Hebrews 11 because they laughed. So I just laughed over this thumb, and I forgot about that I even had my hand wrapped around this little nub. I mean, he didn't have any knuckles, nothing. Just this little nub thing. And I was actually I was praying over somebody else, a young woman who just needed a good father encounter. She just needed to know the Father liked her. Yeah. And so I was just more ministering to her, and I forgot about this nub for 5 minutes. And then I've got a hold of this hand, this nub. And I took my hand off, and looking at both hands, thinking he gave me the wrong hand because he had two thumbs. And he's looking at both of them. He got a brand new thumb. I didn't even feel anything. But he didn't have a thumbnail. So I had my team come over, and they released the presents on him and started laughing. And after 3 minutes, he got the little white part of the thumbnail. I went back to this church 8 months later, and the guy had a fully grown out thumb and a fully grown out thumbnail that he had been going around telling everybody and showing everyone his new thumb and thumbnail that he has to trim every 2 weeks. So, yeah. 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 Okay, now stand up if you need a miracle in your body. Stand up if you need a miracle in your body. You need the justice of God to come into your physical body tonight. You see, she asked me if I wanted to do it again. Of course. Of course. I want to do it again and again and again. I am an administrator of justice. I want to intervene wherever there's something wrong.
What are you doing, my brothers from here?
No, listen. It's not me that does it. It's the power of Christ in me. Like Peter said, don't look at me as though it's my godliness. Right? My godliness or my power that's made this man whole. This is Jesus. Christ in you, the hope of glory. And the Christ in you wants to flow through you to bring miracles. Wherever you go, releasing justice. The justice of the kingdom of God. Right? The dominion of God being released into an atmosphere, into a body that brings about righteousness, peace, and joy. So I want you to partner right now as you're standing with each other. What? I thought you would do it all. Yes, you're going to do it all. Okay, so you're all administrators of justice because you're all Christians. So I want you to utilize the supernatural power of overflowing joy tonight. And I want you to turn to somebody, find out what they need a miracle for. Then I want you to smile, laugh if possible. I know some of you haven't gotten that far yet, but just at least try to smile. Releasing the goodness of God, the kindness of God over them, releasing His presence over them, okay? Go ahead. Everybody who's seated, find somebody who's standing. And you over there, you guys are a sick group over there. You guys are going to need to pair up with each other as well. So go ahead, find out what they need a miracle for. So, don't take a long time. And I want you to begin to check it out. I want you to begin to test it out as you're laughing over them, as you're smiling over them, as you're releasing the goodness of God over them. Whoa! Yeah! Yeah! Shabba! Okay, now just move it around a little. So you've lost all the tendons there, right? The ligaments. Okay, so try to move it. Yep. So, shabba. Yeah, good job. Raise your hand if you still need somebody to come to you. Something happened? Whoa, what happened? Did some of it come back a little? Some of it came back a little? Not yet? Okay, we'll just keep going. Just keep going after it. Yeah. Yeah. Shabba. Yeah, you guys just... Yeah, you guys just heal each other for a little while. Yes. Okay. Okay, now begin to check it out. Stop. 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 Shh. Begin to check it out now. Do something that you couldn't do before. Try to make it hurt.
There's a guy over
yeah.
there. That doesn't,
yeah. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Somebody's praying for him right back there.
Yeah, he needs a call.
Yeah. Yes. How's your hand feeling? Is it good? Nice. May the pain never come back and
Amen.
Full mobility
Amen.
In Jesus' name. Whoa. Okay, everybody sit down. Okay, raise your hand. Raise your hand if you got some kind of breakthrough right there, whether it was 10%, 20%, 30%, 50%, some kind of breakthrough. Right here, right over here. Okay, everybody sit down. Raise your hand really high. Wave it. If you got some kind of breakthrough there, wave it. Did you get some breakthrough at all? What? Good. Well, wave with that hand. Yes. Awesome. Right here. Right there. Right back there. What happened to you? What happened? Stand up. Did you stand up?
My nose, my bone is kind of crooked, and I broke it when I was 3, and then I broke it last November, and then God healed it, and so I just got a bruised nose, but I can't really breathe that well. And over this weekend, I believe I got healed up to like 30 to 40% because I can breathe now out of both nostrils.
Yes! 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 Whoa, come on. Come on. Now, this is what I really love. She said she got probably 30% improvement. She can breathe out of both nostrils, and you guys erupted. Listen, if we can learn to give thanks for the 30%, it'll pave the way for breakthrough. Just like the loaves of bread and the two small fish. Jesus took what he had and he gave thanks for what he had and he got abundant breakthrough. That's a kingdom principle. Every time, listen, every time we declare your kingdom come, he comes. He begins to do something. It may look like 10% right now, but if we can learn to give thanks for what he is doing instead of focusing on what he's not doing, then we'll get abundant breakthrough. So once again, who got a little bit of breakthrough? 10%, 20%, 30%, 50%? Raise your hand again, really high. Come on, this is awesome. This is awesome. What happened to you? What happened to you?
Every time I sit down or stand up, my foot falls asleep.
Yeah.
And so she prayed for me, and my foot quit falling asleep.
Come on, yes. Yes, come on. Wake up, O sleeper. Yes. What happened to you?
I have crooked feet.
You have crooked feet.
And my toes are numb.
Yes.
But my toes are not numb. They're not straight, but they're not numb.
So the numbness, the neuropathy left.
Well,
or numbness left.
Numbness left.
Come on! Yes! Okay, now, here's the deal. When God makes a righteous judgment, when he said, I'm going to release healing on the earth, right? That's his judgment. The works of the devil are going to be destroyed. That's his judgment. Justice is what begins to carry it out and justice never fails. Do you know that righteousness and justice are the foundation of his throne? Psalm 89:14, righteousness and justice are the foundation of your throne. It's like everything that the kingdom rests on. So what we're going to do right now, just everybody stretch your hands this way, and we're going to just say to these toes now, justice, continue your work in bringing about the righteousness of God. You see, righteousness is the right thing. A righteous judgment is a declaration of the right thing. And justice is the administration of the judgment of righteousness. Did you get that? Justice is the administration of the righteous judgment. It's we're giving her what the judge ordered. We're giving her the blessing that the judge ordered. He's not going to break a broken reed. He's not going to snuff you out when you're hurting. He's going to come and release his judgment over you, which is in Christ, all things. Oh, life, abundant life. Whew. So we just say in Jesus' name, those toes line up. We release the shalom, the Irini peace, alignment of God. Who here has back pain? You have back problems. Anybody with back problems, stand up right now. God's going to heal and align back problems right now. In fact, right now, what I want you to do as you're standing is I want you to just go ahead and put your hand on the part of your body that has back pain right now and then begin to move it around. And what's going to happen is your pain's going to start diminishing, even right now. Everybody around them, just go ahead and like point your hands to them and say, God, we release your justice right now. We release your justice. Okay, now start moving it around. Do something that you couldn't do before. Try to make it hurt. Okay, who here got some breakthrough? Who got some breakthrough? What happened here? Come on, look around the room already.
It feels better.
So was it painful? What was the pain level? 10 was the highest level pain.
Right now, probably 4.
What was it before?
10.
Whoa! Yes! Yes! Okay, so this then is the administration of justice. Justice is being realized right now. It's practical. He can measure it from 10 to 4. He just got 6 out of the 10 justice right now. So now who votes for full justice in this battle? Okay, so is it the lower back?
Yeah.
Okay, so just point your hands this way, and we say release a full measure of the justice of God right now.
I will get spasms in it.
Yeah? So is it the L4, L5?
I don't know.
You don't know, it just hurt.
Yeah.
Okay, whoa. Yeah, whoa, yeah, alignment, justice aligns things, justice aligns earth with heaven, whoa, okay, now move around a little bit and see how that's, you feel any different?
It feels good right now.
Can you do something you couldn't do before? What couldn't you do before that would hurt? What?
Get up and down fast.
Okay, so like in a chair, you mean?
Yeah, but I don't want to.
Okay, just try it. As fast as you're willing to go. Okay, now, could you do that before?
Not that fast.
You couldn't do it that fast?
No.
Yes! Yes! Come on! Now, so, like I said the first night, the kingdom of God oftentimes comes as leaven. It works itself in and it expands and multiplies, or it's like a mustard seed. So now we just declare continued restoration, even through the night. Just like Gloria woke up this morning and it was even more restored. Okay, so what happened to you?
Knees. I've got arthritis in my knees, and they get very stiff at times.
And what is it feeling like now?
They're just much more limber.
Come on! Yes! Yes! Somebody else over here, something happened. 10%, 20%, 30%? Somebody else. What's that? 10! Yes! Okay, we'll take 10%.
Yeah. Here.
Okay. Well, what happened?
All right. So last night, or whatever night, the ear thing, you know, yeah. The humming in the ear. Go figure, drums. So I leave here, and all I can remember is give thanks. So I leave.
Oh, that's a good thing to remember right there. If you forget everything else, just remember that.
So like I leave here, and then it was like 100 times, like I was in a big barrel. I'm going, okay, Lord, I give thanks for like. It seems 100 times worse. Does that mean that, like a room I'm cleaning out, it's really ugly and dirty, icky first. Now I don't have quite the buzzing. I don't have the big barrel, and it's a good at least 10% better than the other night.
Come on, yes! Yes! Okay, I just release the rest of it right now. You see, I never get discouraged with 10%. I get encouraged with 10%. I used to pray for people and they got worse. So.
Thank you.
Whoa, yeah. Okay, listen, can you feel the faith in the room increasing right now? Why is that? It's because of the testimony. Listen, the testimony of justice being carried out brings hope to the islands. When you share your testimony of what God is doing in you, it gives other people hope that God can do it in them. And that's exactly why the devil does not want you to give a testimony. Well, I don't want to be prideful. That is the devil speaking. Because the devil knows that if you give your testimony, other people are going to get hope. And they're going to come and they're going to want to receive the same kind of justice you just got from the judge. You see, this is why people are so afraid of God, because they think of judgment as a negative judgment towards them, when in fact God has made a positive judgment about them, a righteous judgment, because He's a right, just God who only does righteousness and justice. You see, this is the judgment that the world is waiting for. This is the judgment that reveals God's kindness that leads people to repentance. So right now, I want you to partner up with somebody one more time, and we're going to release the justice of God on them in this faith-filled environment right now. And this is what the testimonies does. Like, who here believes? I mean, God can do anything tonight. Anything. In fact, if there's somebody, I just heard cancer here. There's somebody here with cancer tonight. And I think it might be in a female, and I think it's in the female organs somehow, somewhere. And so if that's you, I want you to come up to me at this time, and I want to pray for you. I see a lot of cancer healed wherever I go. But otherwise, I want you to partner with, find out. I want you to ask somebody around, do you need a breakthrough in your body? To practice asking people in our everyday life, hey, do you need a miracle in your body? Do you need a breakthrough in your body? Is there anything going on that you need help with in your physical, you know, like a physical ailment or something? So I want you to ask somebody instead of raising your hand. And I want you, to, every single person, to take some risk, step across the chicken line to try out a word of knowledge. Like, hey, do you have a knee problem? Do you have a knee problem? Do you have a knee problem? Yeah, there you go. Okay, so everybody stand up, and we're going to take a prophetic step right now across the chicken line. So ready, go. Okay, now go find somebody, and find somebody that you can release the justice of God on really quick. We're only going to take a few minutes for this, and then we'll do something else. We're almost done. We're almost done. Just ask somebody if they need a breakthrough. Go after a word of knowledge if you can. Remember to smile. Okay.
And I am 90%
cured. Awesome. Okay, I'm going to turn this off. All right, begin to wrap it up. Have them check it out. Have them do something they couldn't do before. Have them test it out.
I had 3 surgeries, and every time the doctor did the wrong surgery on my heart, I'm still here.
Yeah.
And then they did the wrong surgery on my spirit.
Be seated real quick. Go ahead and be seated. That is, oh, hold on a second. So you went back and you checked. Hold on. Shh. So this is the gal who had the buzzing and she didn't really know because she's in the room here and it was so noisy, and you went outside and
I believe it's gone.
You can't hear it anymore out there.
No.
Come on. Yes. Yes. Whoa! Come on! Come on! So raise your hand if you got breakthrough in some way. Like, you got breakthrough in some way. Come on, this is awesome. So what happened to you? Just shout it out. Yep. Come on. And now what happened tonight? You don't feel any pain now. So it was 80% gone this morning, and now it's completely gone tonight? Come on! Yes! You know, that reminds me. There was a woman we were praying for in Bakersfield, California one night, and And she woke up the next morning and the pain came back, and the Lord spoke to her and said, well, actually, she was deaf and the deafness came back. And because it had opened up in the meeting. The next morning she woke up and she was deaf again. And the Lord said, you need to send that back to sender. You need to return it to sender. So she said, I return this back to the devil right now in Jesus' name. This is not mine. And her ear completely opened up, and it stayed open. So, yeah. So when that pain wants to come back, just return it back to sender. Okay? Yeah. Just like put it in a prophetic envelope and return it back to sender. So what else happened? Just yell it out really quick, like popcorn testimony, really quick. What else happened? What happened to you? Can you move any better than you could before? Okay. All right. That's awesome. We'll take a maybe. Yeah. Anybody else? Anybody else? Yeah, what happened? Come on. Yes. Yeah. What else? What else? Somebody else? Just a few more. Yeah, what happened?
I have two teeth that they wanted to do a crown on both of them. And I was prayed for. The pain is gone. There's two nerves. And he's getting one on top, one on the bottom.
Come on! Yes! Yes! What else? Yeah, what happened? Wait, can you hear her? I didn't think so. Okay, I know you don't like this, but...
She had prayed for me, and she had just spoke to some personal things in my past and broke them and just kind of felt a release.
Come on, yes! Yes, that's justice. Somebody else. Somebody else. Over here. Yeah, back there. Yell it out. Come on, yes! Somebody else. Yeah. Come on! Whoa! Yes! Wow. Wow, wow. Wow. Well, I just say, this is not an event. This is a lifestyle. And it's not about me. It's about us. It's really about Him. In us, through us. And I just want to just say thank you guys so much for playing along with me this weekend and just really... coming, I can sense your hunger and from Friday night to tonight, I just sense there's like you guys, I feel like we're just really on the same page here. And this is, for me, this is my joy being made complete, is to watch you guys gaining in confidence and competency in releasing the kingdom of God. And I just can't wait to hear of all the great testimonies of you taking risk, crossing the chicken line to release the justice of God, to establish the righteousness, peace, and joy of the kingdom of God as you go out preaching the good news of great joy. And that was Friday to Sunday night in one sentence. So God bless you all. And thank you so much. And also... Yes. Okay, now let's just shout to God and praise the Lord for His goodness and His kindness. Yes, you are good. 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 Oh, yes. So, Rice Lake will never be the same again. This region will never be the same again. You guys are going to be like diamonds in the night, shining forth and cutting through the darkness to bring the justice of God. So what I'm going to have our team do is come on up here, and we're going to do a justice tunnel tonight. And I've never done a justice tunnel, but we're going to do a little different. We're going to do a justice joy tunnel tonight. And we're going to release the justice of God. And once again, you know, I want to have the pastors here, the leaders, you know, join in this as well. Randy and the youth, just everybody can join. We could do a super slinky tunnel. Just keep it going around the room. But before we do that, I wanna prophesy over you guys. It's Amber, Bree, B-R-E.
Yep.
And Caleb, I almost said Caleb, because you're going to run like I just see you fast. I see you a leader. I see new levels of breakthrough. I see innovation strategies coming for both of you. I've already told you some of this, but I'll just say it publicly that I see new songs coming forth. I see songs that represent the revelation that's being released on the earth today, but in ways that kids are going to really love to sing. And so I see songs like, light 'em up, 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 I'm a fire! You know, and I just see these creative, out-of-the-box worship, praise, celebration, declarative, triumphant party songs. You know, fun. And I just see like kids swarming to you guys because they're going to want to be a part of something that's so exciting. And I see signs and wonders and miracles at the forefront. And I don't know like how much you guys have been going after that in the past, but there's going to come a time when pizza parties and game nights are going to even be more fun, because I see you doing like revival game nights as well. Like you're going to play musical chairs where whoever gets left out has to prophesy over somebody, you know, in the circle. And you're going to play Red Rover, send a hurt ankle right over. And, you know, and God's going to give you creative, innovative strategies. And it's going to be so much fun. And so I just release that, and you guys are going to have fun. And it's going to be like, you're going to look so forward to it. It's going to be like, what is God going to do now? I don't know, but it's going to be fun. And so I just release you guys to the next level of that in Jesus' name. Promotion. Yes. Okay. So are you guys ready? Are you guys ready to party tonight? Is anybody happy in this place? All right, so we'll start on this side. And by the way, I will be at the last time at the book table. I would really encourage you should buy everything I have. And you should buy it for your friends who aren't here. Give it to them so that they can read it and they can get on board with what God is doing in the earth today. So God bless you all and have a great life.